We are in.
Ready.
So, bonjour.
But is it time now? Is it earlier or what?
Yeah, we are starting 1 minute before.
Ah. We wait 1 minute.
How is it going? So, I'm Vinci.
And I'm Carsten, and
I have a microphone.
I'm Carsten, and I am, if you look at the program, I'm the only one figuring because I'm the one who submitted the talk. I am the only European developer, and so I thought I was going to come here and give this talk all by myself. But it turned out that Vince, who is the lead developer of our project, he was able to come over from Brazil to participate in this talk, and I'm very happy to do it. I'm very happy that he did that because he has been working with this project for the last 7 years and knows much more about many of the details. So that's good.
Well, we are going to present our project that's called Baubaxia. And this project is a community-based project that started in a network called the Mocambos Network, that is a mainly Brazilian network from a grassroots network of more than 200 communities. These communities are quilombos, that are Afro-descendants communities that exist since the slavery, and still now there are around 5,000 communities in Brazil. And indigenous communities called aldeas, and there are also some urban center that works with the culture. They are linked some way to this context. I'd like to show a bit to understand a bit more. So Mocambos Network, it's all over Brazil, and there is some places outside also in Africa and Europe. This is to have an idea where the project is based. And as you can see, there is also the name of this map is Rota dos Baobás, means Baobá root. That is our symbolic connection between communities, because we are referencing a tree that is an African tree, very important to Africans, that lives like more than 5,000 years. And we are planting these trees in communities together as a symbol of a free land, a land where freedom is a value. And so we started around more than 10 years ago, Mocambos Network started with the challenge to improve communication between these communities, because they are very far in a rural area, in the Amazon, in places where you have no infrastructure, communication. And we started with we got some connection, satellite connection. You can see these are connection we got with some government program. They give satellite connection to these places, these communities. But we saw that for people in community, orality is the main way to communicate. So we need some kind of multimedia exchange, like videos, audios, and satellite. It's very, very slow. So, and it's not in our hand. We can't control to connect more communities, because it's a technology that we can't manage, you know. So we started to think on developing some technology to create a communication that is compatible with this context. So, well, the founder of one of the founder of this network is an house of culture in Campinas, in São Paulo, that started from an occupation, and since a lot of time they started to look at free software and they started to work with free software. So they had already a big challenge with making education about using free software for audio and video or other stuff. So then we get to the idea to create a pattern of communication that we call some way eventually connected federated network. That is the idea that you are going to show a bit. So let's go back to the. Well, the context is not so easy because we are speaking about a country that is very—it's wonderful, but there is some war ongoing. I'm saying that official data says that there are like 30,000 people killed, black people killed for a year. But this is official data. They estimated is like 100,000 people, black people killed for a year. So this is the reality. Well, Brazil is a growing country and the economy is raising everything that survive and in a very, very fast now speedy because now the company are bigger. It's not small company, it's big company. When they arrive, they take over. And the people that stays on the land, that stays on the territory, is are who can really contrast this, make some really protect the place. So these people is struggling to protect some way the environment and their community way of life. And Baobaxia, you want to speak more a bit?
Yeah, Baobaxia is basically, as the Baobaxia system is built now, it is a multimedia archive. It is a system to share multimedia, video, audio, intended to enable people to share their cultural production and their cultural values with each other in communities which are located very far away in a very rural settings and which have no internet or only very slow internet. So the challenge is, how do we enable people to share multimedia and distribute multimedia even though they are offline?
Well, I said a bit about the origins that we made this joke that is Galaxy of Baobabs, Baobaxia. The name is the reference to the tree, and in Africa, Baobab is normally the place where people join to make the most important happening happens there, and so we started thinking on a digital representation of this symbolic place. And so we say that is a galaxy of shared memories linked to the territory, to the place, you know. So if you want, we can see a bit of images because we are not so poetic to try to share a lot of things that is very dense, very.
We think you should get a glimpse of what kind of world this is going to operate in.
Yeah, there will be some word in Portuguese, but don't scare, we can.
So it's the root of the Baobab trees are more than 100 kilometers, more than 180 communities, all kinds of communities. This is a tree that lives thousands of years, so it's a symbol of the collective memory. A galaxy of collective memories connected to the land. The communities which get a baobab will also get baobakia. Through baobakia you can publish and receive media even without internet. The digital memories of the network are updated on the communities, on the computers in each community. And the data may be transported over internet, or they may be transported physically in a pen drive which people travel around with. You could also travel with a mobile mukua, a mobile server which people travel around with too. So when the traveler comes to a community, he can synchronize the computers and the network.
Que batucava o coração, e ao mesmo tempo serena como lua ou luar do sertão, coisa que brilha, mas não fere a liberdade.
This is a poem from Tessé, that there was the guy that appeared in the first image of the, and he's one of the founder. He's a very long time fighter for of the one of the founder of the Brazilian Black Movement, and he's a musician. And this is to have a beat. So, mukua, what is mukua?
Mukua is a fruit of a baobab tree. And since our metaphor is that a network in baobabxia is the network of all the nodes in a network. So the fruit of the baobab tree is a node of the mukuas. And we are saying, each server in the local community is a mukua, which is, we don't like to call it a server, because a server is somebody who serves us, that is like a slave we have, that is a paradigm we want to get away from. So we consider the mukua as a piece of digital land in which we can sow our culture and let it grow. And that is the point.
Yeah, the idea of to have a different approach to technology, that you are not slavering machines, but you are like managing like you do with the plants. And if you do this, you will see the fruits that will grow. So try to change the approach that we had until now. And this is very near to the practice, because most part of the people is agriculture. And this is a bit of a general idea. So I put a drum in the center, if you note, because we said that the drum was the first internet. So we put it at the center. This technology that still now works, and it's an open technology. Everybody can do. It's a free technology, you know. And people is there are people in communities with small bandwidth or no bandwidth, no connection, like satellite or no connection. There is bigger groups, communities that is more structured, that has different people with different knowledge, that we call like a center for education, that is a reference for local communities, for other communities, that they have maybe a better connection. And then there is people going around, hackers, Mokambola, that they carry portable mukuas, and we are challenging now to have a fiber connection that will be the first communitarian fiber connection to a research network in Brazil, that we are trying to connect and build a communitarian data center in House of Cultural House Tainá. So this is a general idea. So
the idea is that the content is not placed on internet providers' machines, and it's not placed in the cloud. The content of a local community always resides in the local community. The Mukur is installed locally on the local network of each community. And then the data are shared with other communities. Basically, every Mukur maintains a graph of the whole network and can synchronize the metadata from the whole network and can request the actual multimedia files from the whole network. So it's like every installation is locally based under the control of the community and may potentially hold a complete copy of the whole network. It is synchronized by internet if there is internet. If there is no internet, like we said before, it is synchronized by people traveling around. So it is synchronized slowly but safely but surely. And like I said, the content is distributed, controlled by the local community and not by some commercial server. So the data, what's happened with it, its flow is completely under the control of the communities. And how does it work? We have built some software and an infrastructure. We suppose that in each community, there is people have computers, people can access a network. If there is a local network, like a computer lab in the community, we can attach the Mukur to that LAN. If not, the Mukur can have its own wireless card, and we can make a wireless hotspot, which will enable you to access that Mukur's data. And when I come traveling from one Quilombo to another Quilombo, and I have maybe a Mukur on that laptop, then on my home Mukur, in my home Mukur, I synchronize my mobile node with all our new stuff, and I go to the other place, and I synchronize our data with them, and maybe they have requested some data from other Mukurs, which are moving, which may be transported from my machine to their local node. So you could also say that the interchange, the flow of data, is necessarily based on communities where people actually have interchanges. So they need to be living communities where people actually visit each other and transport the data and keep the community alive.
And sorry. This is another part of the system that is not yet really implemented, but the general idea is that we have tags not only to qualify content but to do things like you can associate functionality policies to tags. So for example, you have three levels of functionalities, like rules for distributing and routing the contents, like if I for example, if I tag a content like a patrimonio, that is a cultural heritage, it will be copied to the other Mukurs that works on this kind of decentralized. We are working on a way to auto-recognize community histories. And so the content, if you tag as radio, will go to the community that is working with radio. This is a very easy example, so only to have an idea. And you can also, we are already using this to create as a source to radio, local radios. So you can generate a streaming with the contents tagged as radio, for example. And there is another important topic that is security, because as I said, the situation is a war going on. So this also is a strategic tool to provide some kind of more security and empower this fight, this struggle. So we also think that a lot of content should all this stay in that community, doesn't need to go away, because it's important to the community, available to the community, but should not go out. So if you tag as private, it will not share, will be not shared. And this is the idea. So is to use functional tags as a way to expand, to program the network. So you can have different routes to the contents and different visualization. For example, if you are assessing content to target with radio, you can have default view a playlist or some kind of different visualization, and also implementing different functionalities like a function that start when you are tagging that content with the tag. And well, right now Baobaxia is already working in around 30 nodes, Mukua. And the main use is to preserve cultural heritage and for educational and pedagogic work, because content is community generated, and there is a lot of content about working in this context, like well, we have the agroecological field, but we also work with the energy production, generation with clean sources like hydroelectric, micro hydroelectric. We also building with the recycled, with the vast. We are building also hydroelectric, mini hydroelectric. So we have a lot of pedagogical content. This is the main use right now. So now we go to the good part for us. That is the technical part. And we are working in the idea to create a digital land, you know? So you have to have the basis. So like an infrastructural project. So we are thinking this is Baobaxia, the first application is a digital archive, but we would like to improve as a communication network, general purpose communication network. So the idea is based on Git and Git Annex, because Git is a very wonderful decentralized data management, I don't know how to say that, can have a different history going on, and time by time merge again, you know? Everybody knows a bit of Git, and so we are using not only for code management, we are using as the repository for the data. So data, the archive itself, it's a Git repository. So you clone, each Mukua is a clone of that repository. And because we are working with binary, because it's media, we can't commit on repository Git, because you should duplicate all the contents everywhere. It's not scalable. So we are using Git Annex, that is a very wonderful project from JS, another friend that was formerly from Debian. And then Git Annex is an extension to Git, so you can commit only a link to the real content. So you manage the link of the content by Git, all the potential of Git, but the real media is managed by Git Annex. That is, it can have a map where content is, and it has a lot of functionality to manage these medias. So this is our backend. I can show now in a second how it's made really. And our middleware is an application in Python Django with a RESTful API. And the front end is one front end, the main one that we are already implementing is HTML5 with JavaScript underscore dash backbone. That is, we are trying to create a quite stable general implementation to go to the next level, that is to have more people from the community developing. So the idea is to have local developers that can work on a bigger context without going out from the community, but with the top technologies. So a guy from the community can develop an extension, and this extension can be used in all of the other nodes. So we can have a look. If I resolution is a bit.
The resolution is not ideal for showing this. If you go into the entry of this talk in the FOSDEM website, you will find a link to a Mukura where you can see it in a better resolution on your own screen. But
speak a bit.
This is basically, this is what you see when you enter a Baobaxia. This is right now it's configured to show all the most recent content from the network, and these are photos that are published from events. Vince has now been filtering them for photos. Now they've been filtering for videos, so you can see all the videos posted. The idea is that the main way data are organized is that they are organized by each node, by each Mukura, so you can see the data in one Mukura. Apart from that, you can decide to see, do I want to see all the photos? Do I want to see all the video files? Do I want to see all the images? Or do I want to see all the PDF files or other documents? And these currently are videos from the different communities which are documenting events, if they contain locally produced music, they contain capoeira codas, or everything, all things that are linked to the local Brazilian culture of the community, or in the case of Quilombos, more specifically to the Afro-Brazilian culture. And the main principle of organizing this is, apart from the Mukuras, you can see the data from each local node. The organizing principle is you can tag the data, and then you can choose to see the data which has these tags. So you could also invent the name of a playlist, and then you could tag your audio files with that tag, and then the audio files would be played at the playlist for your pleasure at home, or if you want to compose a radio program.
So we are ready. The project is we are developing with different people from different communities. So it takes lives. Like we didn't plan this. Like sometime it started to work. So people started to publish content. So right now we already have the system working, even if we didn't arrive to a real stable version. But there is a lot of contents right now already. And The idea is that you have only what you want in your community. So in my laptop, there is a small part of the general content. You can see this. You can here there is a utilization control about space that you have in your local node, and well, you can have a look of the network of Mukuas already in working Mukuas. Each of these bolds Mukuas are a community or a guy that is traveling around the community. Like my laptop is Kalakuta, so I can also go to see by community, you know. I'm that in the land, digital land of De Padua, that is where I live. De Padua was a big guy that died. We are remembering that it was from Free Software community also. So we called our Mukua in our community is De Padua. So this is a way to maintain content aggregated by territory. That it's a good way to filter content already, because if you are in a place, it's because you really want to stay there. You are not casually in a place, you know. So we are trying to regain this connection between digital content and real territory, you know. And well, the software has some facility, like different visualization. You can have like slideshows, shuffle, and blah blah blah, multiple content edit. So there is some kind of facility also for usability. And let's go back to see where we were. So there is an online node that is accessible on baobaxia.mocambus.net. Now we were surfing my laptop, that is a node also, Kalakuta. And I believe
I would like to talk something about how you could contribute, because the state of the software you just saw is actually pretty good, I would say. Because with the software we have installed in 30 nodes, and some of the nodes are like Vince's local node, but most of them are actually placed in actual locations all over the world. Now, one in Denmark, which is in my house, one in Italy, some in Africa, but most of them in Brazil and many different places in Brazil, like São Paulo, Recife, Brasilia, Bahia. There are nodes all those places, and there will be more nodes. We have projects to make many more nodes. So the status of the software is right now, it works well, and it is actually used. And the most critical thing is the back end, which will allow the synchronization between the different communities, and that is working very well. We have a very solid platform to stand on. But actually, we would like to do more things. There are some bugs, the user interface could be better. We would like to have more facilities. We would like to have the possibility of hiding stuff. We would like to have better permissions management. There's a lot of things you could do to improve it. You could also use different, you could use a synchronization principle, the offline synchronization principle you could use for different purposes, like for administrative purposes, contracts, digital signatures. But I would like to tell you that the way I got involved in this project was that last year I met Vince at a festival in Bahia in Brazil. It was the first international festival of techno shamanism. And the techno shamanism sounds very weird, but it is also a question of saying, all this new technology, does it only necessarily have to contribute to the advancement of the society which is eating the planet? What use can technology have to the people who still practice ancestral ways of living, like indigenous people in Brazil, like people living in Columbus. And given that we are modern technological people working with technology, could we possibly learn from people with an ancestral way of looking at things? And could we implement that in technology in some way? Like the metaphors of Baobaksha have been inspired by that. But at that event, I met Vince, who was there, and we were talking, and I was saying that, yes, I was from Denmark, I'm working in a company called Magenta, which is specializing in making only free software, and I'm working with Python and Django and databases. And Vince told me, yeah, we're building this system called Baobaksha, which is built on Python and Django and databases, and would I like to contribute? And I said, he explained the distributed model that will be used by the communities. And as a European hacker, I've always been thinking that we are building a lot of stuff, but we are still in the product, producer, consumer mindset. And I've always thought that it would be really nice to have free software really engage and arise in the communities. And so when Vince described what they were trying to do, I thought, yeah, I could do that. So I've been working on this project something, because I've been busy, but I've been doing small things, doing some commits. This summer I went to Vince's place in Brasilia, and we had like a hackathon or a hacker camp with me and Vince and another developer on the system, and we got a lot of code moved. And I'm also involved in a project to create the second international festival of sacral shamanism, which is also going to take place in Bahia, and it is going to take place in November. But the plan is that the first festival was based on a tight collaboration with the local Patashaw Indians or indigenous communities, and this time we want to. We want to establish more relations with the Patashaw Indians. We have a collaboration with three indigenous communities in the south of Brazil, no, in the south of Bahia. And the idea is that we will go to these three communities and make workshops, and we will make workshops in fanzines, multimedia production, and then we presented the idea that they could also be connected to the Baobaksha system. And the thing they wanted most of all, the three indigenous communities, were they wanted Baobaksha. So our plan is to, as part of organizing the Techno Shamanism Festival, we want to organize teams to go to these indigenous villages and set up the mukua, give workshops in the people who can upload content, give workshops on how they upload content, what principles should they use to upload content, and we'll try to see, are there any people here who know anything about Linux systems and system administration, so we can get them to help to maintain the servers, because these are servers which mainly, once you install them, they run themselves. These are Linux servers, they're very stable. But when you have to update them, we still have a procedure where things may break. So if you need to update the server software on your local node, then you need somebody there who has the capacity to do it. But like, and that is, I'm saying this to give an impression to what kind of work you could collaborate in if you wish to. Can you go back, maybe?
You can show a bit of code.
Yeah. No, what I was going to say is that you can, to get started with working on it, you can get. You can check out the code on GitHub. You can try installing a local mukua for yourself. And if you get started on the project, you can contact me. You can contact Vince. We will set up a meeting on IRC or on some video conferencing to get you going well. And then maybe if you want to November, you can come and to the festival in Bahia, and we can meet up there, and you can see the system in action in the. That's one of some of the many things you could do. Also, if you know some NGOs who work with indigenous people who would like to support this kind of thing, which will also help protect nature in Brazil, you maybe they would like to contribute to our work with installing the Mucuas in indigenous communities and giving workshops, helping the people there to administer their notes themselves. And share their culture in that way, and preserve their culture in that way. But yeah, let's see some code.
Yeah, if you see, this is a directory that is the repository where the archive itself stay. And this is the names of the Mucuas. So the first level is basically the place, the node. And then we have a very simple structure, because the idea is to make a resilient system. So if, for example, the interface break, people in the community can surf the directory directly and can have access to the content. They don't have to call somebody outside. They have autonomy, you know. And also because you can, the idea is that you can interact with the system with different paths, with different ways. So you have the main interface, the RESTful API, but you also can interact directly with the contents, with the directory, using also all the Git universe, you know? So this is a Git repository, so we have all the changes in the archive are recorded. You can go back in the time, you can have the system when it was at the first commit, at the first day of use. So it's like quite robust, because if somebody broke your local node, you have other nodes that are unconnected, so it will not spread everywhere. And also you can, if you make a mistake in your node, you can go back. You can have all the functionality of Git. And to show a bit of Git Annex also. Let's see what there is here. I am inside the Mucua directory. So we have in the second level, there is the kind of content that right now is only video, for image, audio, and general like PDF, ODT. And then we have another directory that is Mocambolas are the users. Users are also federated, so user from one Mucua can use another Mucua. And requests that are the requests for content when you, I saw there is this new media, I want a copy. They are stored here. And let's see how is a content itself. Well, there is a year, month, let's do 12, oops. And day, I'm sorry, I'm...
We were discussing this summer if we really wanted this date structure, because we don't actually need the date to represent the media. But we found out it worked. They work as a very good hash function to avoid too long directories.
So the content is for each content there is a JSON associated that contains metadata, and the content itself, it's managed by the Git Annex, as I said. So this is a link, a symbolic link. Git Nutanix put the binary in a subfolder in the subdirectory, and he managed to take to know where there is copy. So we have two copies of these contents in Abdias and Pereira that are two Mukuas. So I can ask to get one copy, one git annex get. Well, if I say get here, it will get everything in this folder. There is only one content. I is going to try to connect to Abdias to take the content. Ah, it's getting already, okay. It will be too much time, but so we are in the real, we are accessing the real system by terminal, but it's the same that you were saying in the interface, you know? So we have this freedom to, for hackers, for user, for and so this is a bit of the how it's really made. And there is another directory that is the code directory where the Django application stay. That is, well, I can show, but there is not so much to, yeah, maybe it's good. Well, if you clone the GitHub repository, you will get this. And real code, the main application is in the app directory. Django, BBC, BBBox. It's quite an easy structure because we have medias, mukuas, user, mocambolas, tag, and repository. Policy is the functional tags. Languages, after okay. And the main application, BBX, BBX, BBX. And I don't know if you want, we can discuss a bit about, and because we have some 15 minutes, okay. And I'd like to share some ideas because we are in a free software world conference, and I believe that can be interesting to discuss different paradigm of communication, and we hope that this can be a field that other people can try to experiment this kind of communication, because we started with we didn't started we want an offline network. We have an offline network. We already had this. So, and we have the problem with the infrastructure. But when we started to develop this kind of paradigm, we started to see that this is it has some advantages, like it's more near to our traditional way to share things with people, because we are not online. We are not always connected. We see time by time. We synchronize. We update, share some ideas. Then we go, each one is in his path, and elaborate, process data, you know, and then can again share some processed data. Now with this online paradigm, you are always looking, searching behind search, after search. And
we also imagine that you have other kinds of communities, like not just indigenous communities, have Brazilian communities, but I know that in the southern Europe, like in Spain, Portugal, there is a movement to retake abandoned villages in the mountains. So they go to the mountains, to places where they build an eco-village or permaculture village in an abandoned old village, and that's in the mountains in Spain, Portugal. There's no internet there, but they could build communities and use this to offline synchronize their video, and they could use it in Greenland. Like, I'm Danish, we have a relationship with Greenland. In Greenland you have very, very dispersed villages with no internet. They could also use something like that. And in a way, we can be humble and say this is the best we can do. We could also remember that this is based on actual research. This is actually something which has not quite been done before. So it's a kind of experimental computer science research.
Yeah, and I believe that the digital land we say is, it's because if you have direct control on this kind of technology, we have the possibility to experiment. Because when you are in an online paradigm, you should have access to some kind of hosting. So it's not everybody that it's so easy to get an hosting or all the complexity of creating this. When you can have this at your home, okay, but we need this common place to experiment that we lose when we pass to the online context. So we should improve our challenge to more popular science, popular technologies. We have to recreate this digital context, local context. So this is a way also to try to challenge this, because when you have a Mukua that is already recognized by the community because it's their archive, so they are already managing that computer, you can start to do other things connecting in that little piece of land, you know, digital land. Well, I think that the time it's over, so I will give you...
We have some
This is very interesting, and it was fun to watch. Thank you. So, do you have any? Is there in your communities? Is there anything like a desire to exchange documents and to collaborate on human writable documents, or something like a wiki that is also backed by this? Or is this something that for your community is not relevant?
We have the wiki.
No, but I don't know.
Okay, the first things that we started using was a wiki. We still have a wiki that is a media wiki, it's online. It's if you look for Mocambo's network, we will get there in our wiki. The idea is after. And so. We would like to implement a wiki in the same pattern, not only a wiki. The idea is to have a communication pattern with offline synchronization, you know. So it's very, now we are starting to think about some kind of tool to help also sharing goods, real goods, like because people over there, they are producing and they are sharing already. But if you have a tool to improve this is to gain autonomy, power, you know. So sure, you already seen some solution of decentralized wiki. But what we need is more people helping. Thank you.
Very, very cool. I agree with what you said about needing to sort of take back local communities and how the internet has centralized a lot of things. It's a worthy cause. One thing that I thought about when you were talking is if you guys have thought about what might happen if somebody were to put something into one of the nodes that really shouldn't be transmitted to all of the different communities, because in one way it's nice because you've got this redundant backup system without really having to do anything. The other way, you know, if a picture or something of somebody in a community got uploaded, that's it's out there forever and there's no way to have some sort of centralized way to delete that.
There is no centralized way to delete it, but there are two things, and that is right now the synchronization is not an automatic process, it's a manual process. So in order to synchronize, normally people update, they see what's on it, then they synchronize, and if they see, I don't want that, that shouldn't be there, then because it's Git, you could always go back and revert that commit, and the content is gone, and it won't be diffused any further. And then if people upload something that shouldn't be there, it's not a technical issue, it's a people issue. So you should also solve it as a people. On the local level, you can delete, you can revert the commit, and if it's out there, well, you make requests to the other communities that they remove it. So you need to handle these people problems in a people way. Do you have anything to add?
Only to it's not automatic, not because it's a script. You have to run a script to synchronize, but we believe that not everything should be automatic. This is we are thinking that maybe when you are sharing things, you need some energy, human energy to invest. So, because you are doing a very, very big sharing, you know, you are passing a lot of information. So this information should have some human interface we are thinking about some kind of moment in period that you periodically meet and have a look on the data on what you are sharing. So it's not only a technical challenge, it's a human challenge to share ideas, information. So I believe that we can invest a bit more before automatic getting everything automatic, you know. And some way, because the network is federated, it's not a general purpose network. You are going to connect to people that you already have a real connection, human connection, not a technological one. So if I see that community started to send a lot of shit, I will call the guys. What are you doing? Dude, are you really going on this way? Let's cut our connection. We are not in the same idea. I don't know. Should have a human interaction.
All right, I think our time is over. So to give you enough time to get yourself to Jansson for the last talk, I think we should.
Thank you very much for coming.